I'm in a mangrove forest in western Myanmar. Though mangroves themselves are difficult to grow, the fate of the people here and the trees themselves are locked together. Find out why in this episode of Your Blue Continent. Southeast Asian nation of Myanmar, or Burma, is a Theravada Buddhist country of 54 million people, with more than a quarter of them living below the poverty line. A half century of military rule, now attempting a transition into democracy, the country has experienced rapid deforestation at a pace three times faster than that of the world's rainforests. The country is so climate disaster prone that the ability of poor people to produce enough food for themselves is frequently in jeopardy. Making matters worse, when muddy waters make fishing impossible and poor Burmese are desperate, the easiest way for them to make money quickly is to chop down mangrove trees and sell the wood for charcoal in the capital of Yangon. But every tree they cut contributes to more erosion, impacting their ability to fish for food. It's clear that a significant societal change is needed to break this cycle. In the same way that problems compound each other, so can solutions. The Worldview International Foundation was founded more than 40 years ago under a vision of bringing public education and taking action with new, effective methods and technology to the world's disadvantaged populations. Worldview, a registered consultant with the United Nations, secured Myanmar's first marine protective zone, the 1,200-acre Tor Heyerdahl Climate Park, in 2012. The organization has identified what they claim to be a miracle climate cure right in front of them there, but it will take a multi-pronged effort to take advantage of it. Worldview was founded in 1979 by Arne Fjørtoft and has carried out operations in at least 26 countries. Now they are engaged in the most ambitious effort in history to reverse a cycle of poverty and environmental loss centered around the restoration of the native mangrove trees. Fjørtoft, now 82, is a former journalist, author, communications specialist, and social business inventor who even chaired the Norwegian Liberal Party in the 1980s. Fjørtoft explained that the mangrove trees were able to restore lost habitats and reverse the effects of climate change, with each adult mangrove trapping as much as five times the carbon of a rainforest tree and creating enough oxygen for four humans.
It's a miracle tree. You will look at it as the solution God left behind. There are already technical solutions for the totality of mankind. This is the solution.
The project is being funded in part through NORAD, the Norwegian Development Agency, and in part through a unique blockchain token called Tree, through the Leica exchange, with each token equaling one tree planted in a square meter in the climate park. However, planting trees is only part of the solution.
The tree suggests a tool. The aim is the people. It is a vicious circle. Unless we can meet the need of the people, this will not work.
Worldview's plan is to plant more than a billion trees over a 10-year period in an area covering 100,000 plus hectares. While that seems like a large number, they've identified a key technological adaptation which could make such an ambitious number a reality. Drones. Utilizing drones, the team is attempting to plant as many as 100,000 mangroves per day, even in areas where humans find it difficult to reach. The project is the first VCS, or Verified Carbon Standard project, in all of Asia, winning approval from Vera to sell 3.5 million tons of carbon last year, with the plan to spread these funds over the 50 villages within the project zone. I knew I had to get out and see this all in action! So we traveled to the Heyerdahl Climate Park project site near the village of Shui Taongyang in the Pantin district of western Myanmar. Here, a new method of pruning mangrove shoots in maturing trees was being utilized after successful university testing. This technique, referred to as regeneration improvement felling, resulted in stronger growth and a 93% successful planting rate. This stunning success was pioneered by project manager Win Maung. Win Maung has been the manager of this Worldview project for 4 years after spending more than 28 years as a government forester and directing the Myanmar Forest Research Institute. There was perhaps no more knowledgeable mangrove expert on the planet to turn to.
We cut on the cyber branch and the root and we clean everything.
So the growth is very big.
So why is it necessary to trim these branches from
here?
Yeah,
if the branches, they are so much, we cannot get the growth.
But naturally, they do grow that way, right?
Yeah, they do. Naturally, they grow very closely. If they are species very wide, they spread their branch and also their root. So we cannot get the growth.
This is a specific strategy designed to get more growth and more height and size.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that something that you kind of devise, your own invention, or is it common to trip them like this?
I'm trained to my staff. Every day we hire over 100 labor. We show them how to make this. Yeah, we cut undesirable branch, roots, and clibber, and weeds.
I can see that it's working. Whose idea was that?
Oh, that is my
it was your idea. You're giving them room to grow.
These amazing trees are the only trees that grow in salt water, known as halophytes. Mangroves are only found in tropical or subtropical waters, where they filter impurities and protect coral reefs, fish, and creature habitats in seagrasses. The trees support the growth of wild fruits, healthy honeybee populations, and provide raw materials for medicines with their complex and extensive root system.
The depth of the root, at least
another meter?
Nearly 2 meters.
Which is like the whole length of my body, down.
The secret of Windmouse technique, like any farmer, is to keep the regenerative parts of the tree away from hungry critters.
The rat and the flying bat, they like to eat this propagule, the seed. Before mature, they eat. We cover the tree and collect the propagule, and then I raise in the nursery. We get the regeneration.
Fjartoft and Maung argue that supporting mangroves is the most cost-effective method of mitigating climate change on the planet. Under their projections, Worldview expects to trap more than 130 million tons of carbon here over the next 30 years, which is more than 3 times Norway's total expected carbon output over that period of time. Furthermore, mangroves are famous all over the world as nature's best defense against rising sea levels and intermittent flooding from storm surge. And the savings for Burmese people from property damage avoidance is incalculable. Altogether, these factors, such as filtering water to increase fishing stocks, which mangroves boost by as much as double, make propagating the trees an investment that is profoundly pro-capitalist. Here in Heyerdahl Park, scientists have observed 23 species of mangrove with 6 primary varieties. Also, animals such as the mangrove macaque monkey and as many as 100 wild elephants have made it their home. Other forms of biodiversity include protecting the 1,000 endangered orchid species with their unique genetic material, all of which is being preserved in a mangrove genetic bank and being protected in the global seed vault located in the Arctic island of Spitsbergen, a place I know all too well after spending a winter driving tourists out there, sometimes at 20 degrees below zero. All of these benefits derived from the mangrove tree make it especially rare as a natural species, the kind that is worth more alive and in the ground than they are as a harvested product. But that doesn't stop people in desperate circumstances from cutting them down for profit when their options run out.
Most of the mangrove trees are gone, making the charcoal. Yeah. That is the biggest problem. The charcoal, as a business, charcoal bunny jobs, they send to jungle.
Basically, part of your job is replacing charcoal, not only as a fuel for the country, but also as a livelihood strategy.
Yes.
To achieve the long-term viability of the mangrove project, Worldview is interrupting the poverty cycle by making community engagement an elemental component. Their goal is to double family incomes in the area, where 60% of locals are often landless. To effectively end the illegal tree cutting, Worldview has supported a Glericidia tree plantation nearby to give those targeting charcoal another option. The project has created over 100 well-paying jobs planting trees and also creating essential infrastructure such as the construction of flood walls, which will protect villages and property. One of these solid jobs has gone to Mr. Mint Hlang, who is himself a former charcoal harvester.
Last 12 years ago, he's working for the charcoal burning. After the Worldview came and he joined the project, weeding and planting the mangrove.
For planting mangroves?
Yes.
So if your job was to cut down mangrove, and now your job is to plant them?
Yes, now we do work here, and we don't do the charcoal burning anymore. He also got a lot of knowledge about the trees.
When it comes to the actual burning of the charcoal itself, Worldview is helping to reduce the amount of charcoal needed. The organization conducted a workshop to teach locals from three villages how to build more efficient cook stoves.
One attendee, Za Win, has been building the efficient cook stoves for the past 3 years, each one consuming about 40% less fuel.
He needs less fuel, less wood or charcoal to burn, and the rate of the heat is stronger than the normal stove.
How much less charcoal are they going to use with this stove?
Traditionally, we eat the rice every day, so to cook one pot of rice with the normal stove takes 25 minutes to cook. And with this stove, it's about 18 minutes.
So you could say like 25% more efficient?
Wynn modifies the stoves to match client preferences and is able to buy all the materials he needs locally. He and his younger son build and sell about 10 per month. He works the rest of the time as a carpenter. Some of the other activities Worldview has supported here include the production of honey, coconut oil, seaweed, and fishing. They've sponsored the introduction and testing of salt-tolerant rice and soybean species, which could also be used for biofuel production. A solar lighting project gave children a tool to study and parents the ability to work at home in the evenings, reducing fire risk from their traditional kerosene lamps in a district that is usually restricted to only 3 hours of electricity per day.
Our organization, not only mangrove reforestation, but also community development, by supporting activities like natural dyeing, clothes, fish and stone making, and plant patterning.
In the center of town, Worldview has started a media center equipped with computers and a library,
where there's an opportunity to work on handicrafts and embroidered goods, as well as learn and practice English.
I'm with the fan. I'm 18 years old. I would love to help my country and local development. That's why it's very useful for me. You can learn the computer and English language and how to use camera and how to use video camera. Yes. So very useful.
I'm Kenanala. My name is Tisha. I want to share and local people. I want to learn English language and computer.
How many books have you read?
I have read 10 books.
You have very nice teeth.
Even though Worldview's direct support is ending, the team here says they will be left on solid footing. Those learning English may play a critical role in helping another group that has been aided through Worldview's assistance. In 2018, the organization helped a group of women set up a clam farming operation and gave them resources to market their clams to nearby hotels where visiting tourists often dine.
We provide the funds initial investment. Once the clam has the market size, they can sell to the hotels and the profits is all them. They don't need to go to the middleman.
Worldview taught you then how to farm clams.
They know how to collect the clam and we build the plot, so they know better than us.
So you just gave them the resources to do something they knew how to do.
They are better than us.
The ladies shared their stories from life before Worldview's intervention.
What was your job before the plantation here?
Find the sand, the fishery product.
What kind of fishery product?
Frogs. Which can be attacked and also fish.
Do you prefer this way of making a living or searching for frogs and fish?
Then it is more relaxed, less stressful. Before she catches the squid or to catch the fish, it's very hard work. Take times and feel very tired because the nature of the squid is not very regular. After they put the clam in there, it's
part of the efforts tied to the ecotourism outreach include bringing hotel guests out to plant their own mangrove tree.
This is a newer business model and has been utilized by one of our series sponsors, Hawaiian Legacy Hardwoods in Honolulu, where Koa Tree sponsorship is baked into the price of every room rented at luxury hotels like the Four Seasons Resort. The planting was a pleasure bestowed upon me, as they gave me the chance to plant a rare species of Rivera hemispes.
This one is a very rare one.
Wow, yeah? I feel so very special to plant this.
One is for you, right. One is for your grandmother, your brother, your mother.
Just grab the bottom and pull it out, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And this one is for my mother.
Wow.
This one is for my grandmother. My grandmother is 97 years old.
This tree will be here in 100 years, I think. Yeah.
This one is for my brother and his family. And one last one. This one is for Joshua. Happy birthday, Joshua. You are remembered by this ultra rare, one of the rarest in the world trees.
So what did we learn in today's episode?
We learned that sometimes a miracle cure for the planet can be the one that already spent millions of years evolving here. We also learned that one way to prevent loss of an important species is providing an alternative target, or tree, for harvesters. And finally, we learned that some new technologies, such as drones, can permit exponential growth potential in ways never thought possible before. Thank you to those who supported our fundraising campaign last year, to our sponsors, Mombasa, and to the great Burmese music used in this program. The Bamboo Trio, Kun Pa Yan, Tele, Song Ubatan, Mama Aye Ubatan, and Myanmar Girls.
I'd like to remind everybody about our initiative called the Blue Continent Fine Arts Alliance.
Located on the websites for ArtSpan, Fine Art America, and Saatchi Art, you can find fine art images from incredible artists around the world that I've had the pleasure of meeting throughout my travels and to develop this series, and some of my own work. We'd like to thank Worldview for their work and for allowing us to cover it on our series. If you're interested in what they're doing, please visit their website here. Or, if you'd like to contribute your skills or knowledge, send an email to this address. Finally, a special thank you to the dude who provided much of the excellent footage for this episode, including the incredible drone photography. I'm sorry, I lost your name. Please subscribe and share widely. Click on the link in the corner to subscribe to our channel. This is our last full episode for this cycle, but stay tuned for some upcoming mini-episodes, including the next one about vertical farming and hydroponics from the mini super state of Singapore.
Until then, I'm Brennan. Peace.
And gave them the resources to market their clams to nearby hotels, where...
What?
Sorry.